Welcome to Stefan Feld Goes to New York and More, episode 261 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
In this episode, we talk about what we've been playing lately. This includes our most recent Walkerville Brewery Game Night, which happened to be a horror-themed game night, and some of the games we played there. We return to Oros and Matches, have more thoughts on This Game is Killer, and more. We wrap up with a detailed review of New York City, the game 3 in the Stefan Feld City Collection from Queen Games.
Before that, some introductions. I'm Sean, and here with me we have our editor and webmaster, Deanna.
Hey there to all my fellow cardboard connoisseurs.
And the tabletop bellhop himself, Mo T.
I'm Mo, the tabletop bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
We record our podcasts live Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop, and we love it when people take part and join us in the lobby, our chat room here on Twitch. Though do note, we are taking some time off in November and early December for the holidays.
This episode exists thanks in part to our Patreon patrons and our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode261. That's 261. Links in our show notes may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing, but help support this show.
Now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games that we've been playing lately.
So recently, we hosted a special Halloween brews and board games event at Walkerville Brewery here in Windsor. It was a pretty good night, despite losing half our space to private parties. But you know what? We didn't fill every table, so I can't complain. Still had plenty of room. The local Blood on the Clock Tower group came out. That was pretty awesome. They hosted a newcomer-friendly game that proved to be very popular. And I packed our bags with seasonally appropriate games and took a risk by taking games that fit the theme more than games we all knew how to teach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a unique night in many ways because we went with a heavily themed game menu, and like 99% of the games we brought fit the Halloween theme. And I didn't know how that was going to go over, but I mean, people seemed to really dig the mix. And as Mo said, the challenge was not knowing enough of the games to teach. Some of these were games we have not played in a long while, so we've forgotten the rules, or ones that I've only played once or twice. And certainly, usually we try and pick a good mix between Mo and I and my eldest daughter that the three of us can teach, right? And this time it was like, well, there's Halloween games here, and good luck to you all.
Yeah, and my problem was, and this is partially due to my current situation, I didn't even have a chance to pre-read the menu in advance. But one of the things that, you know, when we're bringing games that are, you know, we've reviewed and, you know, I know the games, so I'm able to better help direct people and guide people in what games they're picking. Whereas some of these games, I'd never played it. I mean, not only could I not teach them, I'd never played them. I got no idea what's in this box. I'm like, oh, that's Tragedy Looper. It's a game about going around in time and trying to fix things. That's all I know. Good luck. You know, stuff like that. So,
and I gotta say, overall, the crowd was pretty good. There were people who were more than willing to grab a game and open it up and grab the rule book and sit down and learn it themselves, which, to be fair, is what happens at like local game cafes. If you go to somewhere like that, not everywhere has game teachers. The fact that we normally can teach every game we play is something that does make us stick out. So I actually was pretty pleased to see that I could probably get away with that more often, to bring games that I'm not necessarily right up to snuff on, but that, you know, I can kind of help out if people have questions. So I might start including some more older games in our list just after seeing that go over as well as it did. Now, some of the stuff I saw, one group of friends played a long game of Robot Quest Arena. Charlie Brown Windsor in the chat was part of that one, which I just think is amusing because that's now become like their game. That's what they play. So like, I don't think we can not bring it. I think we have to bring that to every event so they can sit down and play their one game of Robot Quest Arena before it moves on. We do still have one expansion at home. The only thing is we are missing one bot. And I meant to ask Sean if you happen to have the bot, because I know you had the game. I wonder if you had the bot separate and it wasn't in the box, because we're missing one of the playing pieces. So
yeah, not that I'm aware of.
Hopefully that didn't go missing at one of the events. So that was fun to see. And I got to say, what's nice about that is that they now have their own thing, so I don't have to teach them. So props to that. We need more people who have their, here's what we do every time, and then we can just let them go.
Yeah, we just need to make sure Robot Quest Arena is packed every month. I'm amused that we now bring it and don't even put it on the menu. It's reserved.
It's there.
Well, it's also one of those games that even if Charlie Brown and the gang weren't coming, it's great to have set up on a table. It's a really good sort of, you know, attract, draw people in game. So even if it's not on the menu, if we were to set it up on a table, we'd still get people playing it.
Now, I did start the night by grabbing a big group because I wanted to see how well this game is killer plays with 10 players. And I had to say that didn't turn out so great. The problem we had, one had to do with the venue. We were sitting under a speaker, so that wasn't great. The other one, though, is we were at this big, long table, and everyone was pretty spread out. Because these weren't necessarily close friends. It was a bunch of strangers. So everyone, you know, took up as little space as possible and were as spread out as possible so they weren't too close to strangers down this long table. And, well, the problem is being able to hear everyone and be able to see everything. So a huge part of this game is being able to see the other players' cards. You don't have to read all the text, but you need to see what location they're in. And yes, there's iconography on the cards and there's numbers on the cards to kind of show it. But once you're at a big table, like this was a big, long table, like probably bigger than my gaming table downstairs. And I got to say, what you need to do is have people closer together. So when we first learned the game, it was like that. It was at a small, like 3x6 table with 10 people squeezed around it, not this massive table. So unfortunately, this wasn't the best learning experience. And I think people would have enjoyed it more if I had organized it better, but I didn't realize that was going to be a problem. So it's now something I know that you need to kind of be in a close-knit group around the table where everyone can see what's going on. But we'll be returning to This Game is Killer in a little bit.
I taught a couple of groups to play Cadaver, which was pretty perfectly themed game, right? I taught a couple to play it, and I was concerned. I was like, I know I played it with you, a two-player, but I'm just like, I don't know if it really plays great at two or not, but I'm going to teach it to y'all, and I hope you have a good time. And they were like, this was fantastic. We loved it. We played it twice. And I as Charlie Brown is saying in the chat, I taught his table to play Cadaver, and they played a six-player game and somehow managed to have a five-way tie. And I don't know. Like, I'm like, did I teach something wrong? Did we break the game? Or did it really just happen to line up that way, right? But they said it was still fun. And it is. It's very themed. And it's quick and easy. And it was good for what we were doing.
Most of the rest of the night, I was bouncing around trying to teach all the various games, or at least quickly read instructions. Again, we decided to stick to themes, to games we know. But I think it ended up being pretty good by the end of the night. Some impatient gamers seemed placated once I got them playing something they liked. I know there were some grumpy people that were a little impatient that we couldn't teach everything or didn't have people to teach everything. But it was funny because those same people by the end of the night were like, oh, this was awesome. I'm so glad I came. So I think it worked out.
It didn't go quite as smooth as usual. It was interesting to see folks playing a holiday hijinks game.
Yeah.
Of course, we brought out the pumpkin problem. And I will say the first table I gave it to, it was a dad with a couple of younger kids. And I showed him how to play it and got the app going on his phone and got him started. And I walked away. And that was one of those games that was promptly returned to me. They clearly did not play it because it was brought back in 6.5 minutes and they went, nope, we're going to try something else. But then later, Tech ended up playing the pumpkin problem. And it was just nice to get to see people playing an escape room game. And it was cool because, you know, we brought out though they ended up starting without the card sleeves and the dry erase markers. I happened to walk by and see that they were doing some really clever things on his daughter's phone to try and pretend to draw on the cards without drawing on the cards. And I was like, oh, wait. We have a solution for that.
Yeah, we should probably pre-sleeve those, like before they go to the go ahead, get handed out to the table. Yeah. They should be
sleeved. But then they won't fit in the package.
That's
the problem when you do that. We need a bunch of photo cases for each one of them then, or something. I got to say, it did encourage me to bring out more replayable escape room stuff. Mm-hmm. Like maybe even that the side quest Nemesis I could see bringing out.
I don't think we have that one anymore.
Okay, weird. Speaking of the dad and the kids, once they were done with the escape room, I ended up teaching them Ghost Fight and Treasure Hunters, which they loved. One on their first play, then I showed them the expansion. The only frustration that happened is they were extremely upset that they couldn't go buy the game because it no longer exists. They would have bought it right there, right then and there off of any online game store if you could find a copy. So I did suggest they call local stores and see if anyone's carrying the anniversary edition of the game, which is the new version. But I think that's the first time I've ever had someone angry that they couldn't buy one of the games we were showing off, which I'm sorry, my collection isn't the new hotness all the time. We're not always showing off some older games do go out of print.
But didn't that anniversary edition just come out? I would assume that's going to be available. I don't know. I've had trouble with that one in Canada in the past. I had a really hard time getting the expansion here in Canada. So that could be it, too. I love that because they had tried a few games before that and they were not finding a good fit. They take a game, they bring it back 7 minutes later. They did that with about four games before we got Ghost Fighting Treasure Hunters to the table. And then they had a great time. So I love it when you find the right fit.
It does appear to be out of stock everywhere in Canada.
Like I said, it's gone. You cannot get the original version anymore.
No, the anniversary edition is out of stock.
Oh, the anniversary too?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
See, the anniversary is not even the same game, so that's another disconcerting. There's similarities. I need to try it, but I don't know when that'll ever happen. Another game I taught multiple times is The Night Cage. I actually taught this one three times throughout the night with different groups, and it was a hit every time. Though I did notice that about halfway through the first game, each group was like, now that we know what we're doing, we're going to have to play again. Like, mm-hmm. We've got it now. We've got the communication. We're not messing up. We know how the wax eaters work. Everyone, I had to help with the wax eaters every time. And the monsters are one of the trickier parts in that game. But then every group, when they were done, I was like, oh, are you going to try again? They're like, nah, we've had enough. Which I thought was a little just surprising. Now, I think, though, that it's the amount of stress at the end of that game. Because the fact that we've called this out during our review, this is a game that gives you that tension, that feeling of isolation. The getting frustrated with the other players when communications break down and stuff. And I just think by the end of the game, you're just like, I'm spent. I'm done.
Yeah.
But then these same people were like, are you going to bring that next month? So it was kind of an interesting experience to see that happen. Like not once, like twice that happened.
I think they had a good experience, but didn't want to repeat it right then. Like you said, it's exhausting. You're like, now I need to go find something fun to do.
Yeah,
exactly. And the timing on that game is really fiddly. It's a fiddly game where you got to get the timing right. And if you don't, it kind of breaks down. And there's that lovely chart on the back of the instruction booklet. And if you're following that, you're good. But if you haven't discovered that chart, you're out of luck.
The one interesting one, I had actually got someone to grab Nyctophobia and go take that. And I thought I had been clear. I thought I had been quite clear in what that game was involving. But then I think I forget which one of you went over to do the teach, and it became clear that there would be touching happening.
Yes.
And they tapped out pretty fast. And I'm like, no, you're going to be blind. You're blindfolded and you reach out and touching. And I thought I had made it clear. But I
heard you say it. I was there at the table when you said it.
But I guess it hadn't really sunk in. And so as soon as the teach started and they realized there was that blind touching, it was just, nope,
tap out. There was one person out of four. I was the one that went over. There was one person out of four that was like, oh, hell no. Like, okay, that's I understand.
The true horror of the game. And do not
true horror of the game. Strangers. Is well, they weren't even strangers. They were all friends.
Yeah, they were, you know.
But I understand. Not everyone wants to be touched in the dark, I guess. That same group, though, after returning Nyctophobia, I taught the Deadlies. That was their first time out, and Nyctophobia didn't go over that well. They also tried the Night Cage during the night, but we got them hooked with the Deadlies. So again, this game seems like it can't fail. They absolutely adored the Deadlies. This was another one where people are taking pictures of the box on their phone so they can go shopping the next day. I'm giving them the, the websites for our local game stores saying, hey, check these places out. I don't know if they have copies, but, you know, give them a call and see if they have copies. If that doesn't work, give them my own contact info because I'm like, I could probably find somewhere to find it. So yeah, the Deadlies still huge. Like just and I don't know, was it thematically appropriate? That's up for debate. One of the games I actually played, mainly because I just wanted to show it off, is Click Clack Lumberjack, which honestly has proved to be very popular at the venue. And I'm starting to think like it's light and it's a kind of small box. Maybe we just toss that in the bag. I actually already have a request for our November game night to bring more dexterity games. They kind of, someone wants to focus on those. So I think that. This is, it's been popular. People take their cameras out. There's people taking videos. One of Gwen's friends from school was there and I think did a TikTok while she was playing TikTok of Click Clack. So I don't know. I think it was kind of cool. What's weird though is we have like a bring every event aisle now, right? I don't put these games on the menu, but we bring it every time. The Robot Quest is one, but like Azul, we tend to bring every time. We bring Zensu because someone's obsessed with it. And whenever she's bored and has time, she'll play it. But like no one played the regulars this time. And I think that's because it was the thematic game events. Like, right. Like, no one played Gokuku. Like we talk about how everyone plays Gokuku every event. No, no one wanted to build a bird's nest. It's Halloween. Despite there was a table playing Boop. I do think that got played. And sadly, I didn't own Boop or else I would have brought that. But like no one played Catan. And honestly, that's what made me glad that I did stick to thematic games.
See, I remember telling you to grab Click Clack Lumberjack, and you're like, that's not Halloween themed. I'm like, yes, it is. You're practicing your axe wielding skills. Come on. It's perfect.
Which is the boat, the boat game, the boat next game?
Riffraff?
Yeah, Riffraff.
That one stands out.
Every time I brought it and set it up, no one's played it. So I don't know.
I don't remember you actually bringing some of that on.
Yeah, okay. I had it set up twice, put it on a table, and then I put it away to pull out other stuff because no one would touch it.
Okay.
I don't know. Like I said, we had requests for dexterity games, so I might make a dexterity game heavy list for next month.
The reason I don't have Nemesis is I think Gwen took it as a prize for her extra life event because I had offered it to her since we were done with it and it was reviewed and it was done.
Okay.
As she was having raffles at her, she had an extra life event at her school, which was fairly successful, though she was sick and ended up not being there that day, which was high stress for her. But
playing with friends and family at home, another one we played a couple times is Oros. This is the board game that reminds me of Populous, right? The old Amiga game where you're a demigod using your powers to shift and manipulate the landmass, which you are doing in this particular game. And you're smashing land together to make mountains. And then you move your followers on top of those mountains to build temples, which increases your wisdom, which makes you more powerful, eventually trying to win, getting the most points. Recent plays did go better than previous ones, but this is a game that 100% does not fit our recent topic of games that are fun on turn one. There is a serious learning curve here in both figuring out exactly how the actions work, how to use them, and then what order to build temples. And it's got that do a thing, but you help out everyone else, and figuring out when to do the thing. And like, honestly, even at this point, it's still going to take me a few more plays before I've got a final verdict on this one. I'm enjoying it, but there's a learning curve. It's clunkier than I want. I want it to be fun, smashy mountains and building temples. And it's more, oh, they moved this piece so I can't. And now I did. Now I don't have enough guys. So I have to, there's too much of that.
I like the game. I want to love it, but I don't know. There's something, I think I'm finding it very fiddly. Like, I think I'd enjoy a computerized version more, one where it did all the slide, the land masses around, build up volcanoes, put new island stuff out there just automatically, and you don't have to waste time on it because that, I don't know, just feels fiddly, kind of, on some level, it's not doing it for me.
Well, I mean, you can get Populous on Steam for like $5.
It does give Populous vibes, and I do love that game.
I told you we'd be back to it. This game is killer. Hit the table at Brenda's and played so much better with us all around a smaller table. Probably could have been even better if we took the leaf out, but it was good enough. Lower player counts, I actually thought was a little nicer too, with everyone nice and close. I think we played 4 games in a row. It might even been 5. This is a game that does fit that topic of fun right from the start, but it does get more interesting with system mastery. And that's the thing I found now, having now played the game about 10 times, is that you start to know the cards. And once you start to know the cards, you're going to learn certain things. Like blowing out the airlock not only gets rid of the airlock, it gets rid of the airlock cards, which include certain actions that won't happen again. And when this room's destroyed, you now know, well, there can't be a corporate trader. Like there is a learning curve there. And I think that's fascinating. And I also found it very interesting to see how different the game feels when playing it with different groups. This game is very group dependent. Now, some groups seem to want to treat it as a social deduction game, which is not what it is meant to be. That actually kind of ruins the game. On Board Game Geek forums, there is an entire thread where the designer puts in caps letters, "This is not Among Us," which I thought was pretty amusing. Now, personally, I enjoy the game way more when you play as intended with no discussion and it's a rapid fire playing of cards with no talking ahead of time. That's how it's designed to be played, and that's how I find it fun.
Player elimination. That's all I got to say. Games with player elimination are sometimes not fun, and this one has player elimination. The game's really quick, but it can sometimes go longer. Like, if people are surviving, you can go a long time. And when we played at my mom's the other day, we had two games in a row where I was knocked out in round one, and that is less than fun. And one of those two games went pretty long. So that was a long time of me sitting there going, wow, I've played two rounds of the last 32 of this game. But it's random. Things happen. I will say, I know it was a hit when Gwen brought it to her board game club at school, where, yes, kids were making many comparisons to Among Us. But they were saying it as a good thing. They're like, oh, this is like Among Us. Therefore, this game is fantastic.
Next, something to prove we don't just play a game, review it, and never talk about it or play it again is a full game of Matches. And I got to say, everything we said about it during our review stands. This is a fantastic modern card game. It's I love the traditional card game feel. And I am still utterly baffled by the comments on Board Game Geek about this game and people saying, well, it's just rummy and it's just this, because it's not. It is so much unique things going on in this game. The collecting of sets, the semi-auction, I guess it is, the bidding, whatever that is, where you're trying to match the number, and then the potential of racing to be the first one out to collect that bonus token and to be able to go first the next round, deciding what cards to keep in your hand for the next turn. There's just so much going on in this game. Yeah, and it was just...
I'm baffled by that as well, because I think it's one of the more unique among the standard card games that we've tried out. I was happy to get this one back to the table. It is still just so good. Like, we were playing it and I was like,
yeah, some of the negative reviews I've seen of this don't make sense to me. I'm like, it doesn't feel like they have played the same game I have, to like that difference of opinion.
Oh, I agree.
And I don't grasp it. So, we strongly recommend this game. Even if it wasn't from a friend of the show, we would still definitely recommend this game because it's just fun to play.
Next up, one of the most extreme board game plays we've probably done since we started this podcast. We were so wrong on this game, and it was so baffling because I was just like, this doesn't feel right, but it's working. And just confused. And this was Stefan Feld's New York City. Now, it had been quite a while since we broke this one out. Last time we played it was at my Uncle Claude's when we were up north in the summer. So it's been a while. And I did a quick flip through the rule book, but I trusted my memory a bit too much and we paid the price. So the rule I missed is at the start of your turn, you draw three cards from the deck and then you draft cards from this market for the rest of your hand. Well, I missed the drawing of three cards. So instead, we just started with the drafting and played the entire game with hands of only four cards instead of seven. Now, this is an auction game where you are using those cards to bid in six different auctions. Note, you only have four cards now, so there's no possible way to like bid in every one, and it's pretty much impossible to bid more than four in an auction. The funky part, though, is it kind of worked. Like, I think we invented New York City Extreme, because we ended up with this super quick, super tight game that was done in under half an hour. And yes, it felt wrong. Like I was like, this doesn't seem right. Like, we don't have enough skyscrapers. The boroughs, it's way too hard to score. And I remember having ways to be able to like put things in the X, but it was done and over. And honestly, I got to say, if you want the experience of playing New York in a super rapid fire tight way, I think we found you a variant.
Yeah, actually, like, we broke it, but it broke in a good way. I might actually intentionally do that again sometime. Proving extreme is not just for that first play. I will say, we're playing it and something's niggling at me. This just feels wrong. I'm like, how on earth do you possibly get a guy in every borough to get that bonus card? That doesn't seem feasible. Wait, how do you get the level 5 cards over here from the elevator? My elevator's never going to go up to the 5th level because 4 cards. And I'm like, I guess if you played all four cards and then you were the one that won the auction, you would get to the 5th level. That's a pretty fringe case. Not too many people are getting those scoring cards. Wow, this game is tight.
Now, due to how quick that game played, it did mean we had time for a second game, and we extreme that one too. Not nearly as bad. This wasn't as bad. This honestly was pretty minor. I don't even know if it mattered all that much. But what we did was, instead of wiping the board and resetting it up and following all the setup rules, which I did the first time because I knew it had been months since we played, we just kind of reset everything and like wiped everything and went, okay, there, we're set up. Let's just play. Let's start with the same citizens we drafted last time. Let's just get going. Well, I totally missed the fact we hadn't put one building of each color into Burrow X, which is something you're supposed to do during setup. Now, I don't think this would have affected the final score as far as who won, but it might have changed how we played during the game, with especially the claiming of the routes might have gone different.
Yeah, it's hard to say. I will say the game, even when you play the full non-extreme edition, it plays nice and quick. And that's not something I can say about many of the Felds we've been playing lately.
And even though we messed up, we had a good time. So of all the city collection games we played, which is four of them, I think, at this point, three, I don't even know now. Anyway, this is the easiest and most straightforward. So stick around, though, because we're about to do a detailed review later in the show.
And now, a message from our sponsor.
One of the lesser-known games that Grand Gamers Guild brought to North America that we personally really enjoy is the Belgian Beers Race. Now, some of you know this, some of you don't. In addition to being pretty hardcore board gamers, Deanna and I are also quite the beer snobs. And while every beer snob knows, some of the best beer in the entire world comes from Belgium.
The Belgian Beers Race is a board game where you take a hiking trip around Belgium to try some of these fantastic beers. You race around the map, trying out as many beers as you can and collecting glassware and bottle caps along the way. Go check out a review to find out why we love it, and it's for more than just the theme.
Well, today we're here to tell you about the Belgian Beers Race Dice, a new, quicker game at a much lower price point based on the original game. It is also a collaboration between Grand Gamers Guild and BYR Games and features the same artists as the original game, who's an actual Belgian beer label designer.
This is a roll and write where you will embark on a wild, unforgettable race across Belgium, where breweries are your checkpoints and beer is your fuel. For three exhilarating days, you'll crisscross the country, visiting as many breweries as you can. The goal? Savor the finest brews, collect bottles, and chart your way to victory, all while keeping your wits about you.
You can pick up this new dice version of the Belgian Beers Race direct from Grand Gamers Guild for just $29.99. And I gotta tell ya, I'm super eager to check this one out.
And be sure to use our code BELLHOP, B-E-L-L-H-O-P, to knock 10% off of that. The classic Stefan Feld board game Rialto is back in a new form as New York City, which retains the original card drafting and area majority focus, but features even more player agency.
New York City is the third game in the Stefan Feld City Collection from Queen Games, who we do have to thank for providing us with a review copy of the regular edition of the game. This is a 1-4 player area majority game that features tons of little auctions. So far, it's the simplest of the city series and plays in about an hour, even at the full player count.
Now, Mo noted that we're talking about the regular edition of New York City. There is also a deluxe edition, which features some upgraded components, but there are no actual changes to the gameplay. So everything we say here will apply to that version as well.
Mm-hmm. As it stands, even the regular version of New York City is pretty impressive physically, as all the games in the city collection have been. You get a lot of chunky wooden skyscrapers and other wooden trackers, standees for all the transportation routes, thick cardboard character tokens, bonus tokens, and more, and a rather large board that makes it easy to see who has what majorities and what each borough of New York is worth as their values change throughout the game.
Now, as far as production, I have no complaints about the physical components at all. Personally, I don't even feel the need for the deluxe components at all. Nor do I do admit having every player's skyscraper looking different and be silkscreen is nice, but totally not needed. My big complaint, though, is the rulebook, which was poorly translated from German and is missing some key bits of information. Sadly, if you pick this game up, you're going to need to head over to BoardGameGeek and check the rule forums, or perhaps watch the official How to Play video. Now, that was put out by Paul Grogan of Gaming Rules, and he makes sure to cover everything and cover it correctly. No, we will also point out the mistakes in the rulebook in this review.
And those rulebook issues are a total shame, because without them, this is by far the simplest to learn game in the entire Stefan Feld City series so far. Yeah. It is so much quicker and more accessible overall than, say, Marrakesh, that it is a great entry point. And it's a shame that they kind of botched it with the rulebook there. Though, you know, I do love me some Marrakesh.
Now, setup is pretty quick, with the biggest thing being separating the characters by level and putting out a 5-level market next to the elevator board. We use a different baggie for each level to make this quicker. Now, each player grabs a player board, picks a pair of starting characters, a level 1 and a level 5, from a number of sets equal to the player count plus 1. Note, how many isn't in the rulebook? Yeah. Now, you grab 4 skyscrapers, grab $1, grab 2 cards, and place them face up to become your initial reserve. Note, face up, another thing missed in the rules.
Now, out on the board, each borough of New York is assigned a random value and a random sequence. Then 2 neutral black skyscrapers are placed into each one, and 1 skyscraper from each player is placed into the borough with the X. Player order is determined randomly, and players' press tokens are stacked at the start of the press track in that order.
That press track is very important in New York City, as it determines both the player order and is also the global tiebreaker for all of the game's multiple auctions. And then, even more importantly, when you get to the game end for area majority scoring, again, that's your tiebreaker. And getting far up enough on the press track even also awards some endgame points straight up.
New York City plays over 5 rounds, with each round having 4 phases. Phase 0, you set up the round. Phase 1, you draft cards. Phase 2, you play through 6 bidding rounds and take actions. And phase 3, you get to use phase 3 characters. Phase 0, the mayor moves to the next borough. You reveal prestige tiles and prepare cards for drafting by setting out a number of pairs of cards based on the player count. An important part of this phase we missed once is that everyone draws 3 cards. Don't do that. It makes for an interesting, quick game, but not the game as intended.
Now, phase 1's pretty simple. Players draft cards in reverse order of the press track, grabbing 1 pair each, and then going around the table again, a second pair. Now, this is a significant change from Rialto, where you got 2 random cards and then drafted a set of 6 cards and discarded 1.
Phase 2 is the meat of the game, and it's broken into 6 single bid auctions, which starts with the person highest up on the press track, but then will swap to the person who won the last auction going forward through the round until each one is completed. Each auction does the Puerto Rico thing, where everyone who bids gets something, but the player who wins gets a bonus. In addition to playing cards from their hands, players always have the option to freely swap out the cards that are laid out in front of them in their reserve. But you can't actually ever play the cards in your reserve. Like, you're only going to play the number of cards in your hand, and you have to take a card from your hand, put it in your reserve. It doesn't give you extra plays. There are also wildcard cards that can be played as any other card, but only when they are paired with an existing card and never on their own. And you can play any 2 of 1 card as a single other card.
The first 2 bidding rounds are simple. In the press round, players go up on the press track equal to their bid, with the winner going up 1 extra. And in the dollar round, players collect dollars equal to their bid, with the winner getting an extra buck. Elevator bidding is a bit more involved.
So bidding in the elevator round lets you draft one of the character tokens. These replace the buildings in Rialto, and unlike Rialto, there are a number of different buildings at each level that are drawn from separate decks. Now, each character has an ability that affects one of the game's phases, 1, 2, or 3, and some provide you with endgame scoring opportunities. Your bid determines which level of character you can select, what floor of the elevator you can reach. And the winning bid gets to draft 1 floor higher than their bid. So if they bid a 3, they can actually draft a level 4 character. Once everyone's chosen their characters, the holes are refilled from the decks, which is something else missed in the English rulebook.
For most characters, you have to pay them a dollar, and each character can only be used once per round. The paid dollars sit on top of them to mark that, and then they get discarded in phase 0. There are a lot of different character abilities, and similar to other city collection games that we've reviewed, Queen has provided an addendum that lists all of these cards by numbers. Unlike other games like, say, Hamburg, the iconography here isn't that bad. It's actually pretty easy to understand. After a couple of plays, you shouldn't need to reference the addendum very often. It's not like we need three copies of the table, like we do with, say, Hamburg.
The next bidding round is for building plans, and it's simple. Take new skyscrapers from the supply equal to your bid with a bonus of one if you win the auction. After that is prestige. The first part is easy. For every prestige card, you get 1 point.
Now, where things get complicated is for the winner of the bid and the player who bids second highest. They each get to take one of the round's two face-up prestige tokens and place them onto the board into a matching burrow, raising its value at the end of the game. They then place one of their skyscrapers into that burrow if they have one available and collect the matching transportation tokens. Now, these are important for endgame scoring abilities on some of the level 5 characters. Now, another bit missed in the rules that if only one person bids, they place one token the others discarded, and the fact that players have the option to not place a token if they do win or come in second and they don't want to increase the value of a burrow.
The final bid is for skyscrapers. For every card you bid, you place one of your available skyscrapers into the district where the mayor is. The winner gets to place an extra one. The important thing to note here is that it's only the borough where the mayor is. That's the only spot that you can place your skyscrapers during this action. And that's something people tend to miss on their first play.
The first player gets a skyscraper in all 6 boroughs at the end of bidding round and scores 4 bonus points. At the end of the game, every player who has built in all 6 will get 3 bonus points. And yes, that stacks for the player who was first.
Now, phase 3 is simple. Anyone who hired a character who has a phase 3 ability can now activate them, paying a buck as usual. You then jump back to phase 0 and do it all again, drafting new cards. The mayor moves to the next district until the end of round 5, when you do final scoring.
Players get points for all of their characters equal to their value, and then score additional points for characters that have final scoring abilities. Every player will have one of these from the start of the game that scores them points for having skyscrapers in 3 of the game's 6 boroughs.
Next is the area majority scoring, which is actually quite simple. Boroughs are scored one by one. The player with the most skyscrapers scores the total value of the borough, its initial value, plus the value of any prestige tokens placed in it. The player with the second highest score, that value divided in half, rounded up. The player with the third highest scores the second highest score, halved and rounded up, etc. It's always the last score divided in half, rounded up, with all tiles determined by the press track. Ties determined by the press track.
Players who've reached the last space, or at least space 5 on the press track, get a bonus 3 points. Then everyone adds up their leftover skyscrapers and dollars, divides that by 2 rounding up, and adds that to your final total. Player with the most points wins. If there's a tie, well, you know how that's broken, the press track.
That's actually way simpler than that sounded. That last bit sounded needlessly complex. It's not. The game also includes rules for playing against the automatic player. Actually, Tom, or even more than one Tom, can be included at any player count. Tom has a matrix of difficulty levels based on both how hard he is to beat and how predictable or erratic his play mode is. There are a number of gameplay changes when using Tom, including how drafting works. The fact he never activates his characters. They are used for endgame scoring only. He doesn't use blueprint cards, and he always builds from the supply. It's enough that instead of covering using Tom in detail here, we're going again to suggest Mr. Grogan over at Gaming Rules and his solo playthrough of New York City, if you'd like to see how that all works out.
Thank you, Mr. Grogan, yet again.
So what isn't clear from all this is just how smooth and quickly all of these auctions and phases happen. Phase 0, get 3 cards and set things up. Then look at those 3 cards and the board state and your characters, and then use that info to draft sets of new cards so you build a hand of 7. Then you have some really fascinating choices where you have to decide what to do. Do you try to take part in every bidding phase so you always get something? Because if you even bid 1, you get something out of it. Or do you want to try to win some specific auctions or bid really high in ones to make sure you get them? Now, the cards that come up will drive some of this, right? You can't bid in the dollar round if there's no dollar cards for you to have drafted. Or your previous actions will also tell you some things, like you don't want to win the skyscraper auction if you don't have any on your board. In that case, you're better to win the blueprint auction so that you have some skyscrapers. And if you're in looking at that, are you going to try to do both so you can get them and play them on the board in the same turn? And then as phase 2 plays out, you'll get to use your characters to modify your bids. And a big part of it is reacting to what the other players are doing. You may end up using a reserve, or you may decide to win an auction you weren't even planning on taking part of due to what the other players bid. And often you're like, well, no one bid. I might as well bid something to get something because no one else is getting something, right? And then there's the decision of which characters to draft. That's a fun part of the game that can lead to some interesting combos. And then being able to place those prestige tokens can be huge, but that can be a double-edged sword. Because if you start increasing the value of a borough, that encourages other people to suddenly start building skyscrapers there. Especially if you're increasing the boroughs that haven't, the mayor hasn't been to yet. Right? It's a little safer to up that place that already happened two rounds ago, but that one that we're gonna hit to the last round, it's always kind of scary that someone might sneak in some extra skyscrapers. Now, the best part of all that and all this is that all this fun and all these decision points and all this, you know, trying to decide what to bid fits in under an hour with experienced players. And it's always awesome. I love this and a few other games where you're putting stuff onto a map. It just looks so awesome at the end of the game to have this map of New York with all these skyscrapers on it. Like you're literally building a New York skyline as you play the game.
That is my biggest thing about this game, is just how fast it plays. Well, feeling like you played a game, and it's satisfying. You don't get to that end round and go, I was just getting going. Stop. We need one more go around here. This isn't it. It's just perfectly timed, so it's very satiating, but surprisingly quick for a nice meaty build. I would rather be playing something a little more complex like Marrakesh, but if we're going to play something that's like half a step down, this is it. This is the perfect.
So does this feel like I don't want to say not beginners, but the intro to the City series? Is this where you might want to start? Somebody who's not a Feld fan, who's not into the heavy games, rather than something like Marrakesh or Hamburg, which you might just burn them out.
Yes. No, I got to say, yeah, I do think so. I'm actually kind of surprised this isn't number one in the City series. But then Rialto was never a huge hit. It's one of Feld's earlier games, kind of before he became the big name that he was. So I think they didn't want to be like, bang, check out the City series. We reprint his oldest game no one's really heard of. So, but I do think it is of all the games we played in the City series, this is the easiest to teach, the quickest to learn, and the fastest to play. I would say it's the most accessible Steffenfeld game out there and a great gateway to his style of games. Now, yes, it's an area majority game, and it feels like you want to have the majority and the most boroughs to win the game. But this is a Steffenfeld game, by the way. This is a point salad. There are lots of ways to score points, and sometimes coming in first in as many boroughs as you can isn't going to get you the highest score.
It's pretty simple and straightforward, and I love how easy it is to teach to people and how it makes sense right from the beginning. You don't need to get four turns in to finally figure out what the heck is going on. It's also really quick to get to the table. It's not an elaborate setup at all.
Now, one thing I noticed here as we're discussing this is, unlike Marrakesh and Hamburg, there don't seem to be a whole lot of other things you can add in. Are there really no expansions to this one?
No. So that was something that I don't know if I should call it disappointed, but being, I think, the fourth game in the City series we checked out, something I thought was a feature role of all of them was that you got optional modules and promos and expansions. So Queen Game is very well known for what they call Queenies, small board game expansions that they tend to give out at cons and as promos. I think you can buy them on their website. And one of the City series things that they've done is included all these Queenies and sometimes full board game expansions in with the new versions of the games. Even Marrakesh, which is a brand new game, not a reprint of an old game, I think had 10 optional modules you could throw in. None of that's here. There's absolutely zero. Except for the rules for Tom and solo play, there's no bits and bobs. There's no optional modules to remove or add. Now, in a way, this makes sense because, again, Rialto's an earlier Feld game and it never had any expansions for it. But I was kind of shocked there wasn't something. Now, the other thing, though, that we have come to learn from the City series that is very much here is how much space this game takes up. So far, every game in the City series, I'm like, I feel like someone at Queen decided that these are big games and that means physically big as well. they have massive boards that are the size of the box, folded in four. So four times your box top is how big your board is. And that has been the case for all of the city series we played. And New York City is just way bigger than it needs to be. Plus, in addition to the main board, every player has a player board. Then they also need a space above their player board to hold their citizens. And then they need, technically, it's a space below. We tend to put them to the side for the reserve. And you start the game with your reserve being two, but a bunch of the citizens can make it bigger. Then, while you're doing the drafting phase, you need to lay out pairs of cards equal to the player count times two. So you need somewhere to put those pairs out where everyone can see them. And all of this just takes up a significant amount of space. Now, no, it's no Marrakech. I don't think we're going to see a, well, maybe we will. I don't think we're going to see a New York Essential Edition with a smaller board. I don't think it's quite at that level where it's needed. But this is going to take up your kitchen table, right? It's going to fit at a kitchen table. But there's no way I'm going to be playing this at my average coffee shop. I'm not going to be able to bring this to a coffee shop table. And I don't think it's a good choice for a bar unless I want to stick my beer right on the table.
Now, in Marrakesh, one of the things that was in the classic edition that we got that we really wish would have been up, we could have gotten an upgrade version, was those walls. It was that one thing that made us wish that we had better than the classic edition. Is there anything like that in New York? Is there anything that you're really wishing? Oh, that's the one thing that I wish.
No, I just want them to make the cafe travel edition. It just, as Mo said, it seems to take up more space than it needs to. And well, the player boards are very useful, very utilitarian, and they keep you on track. They could be a tiny bit smaller. The main thing is that main board is probably twice the size it needs to be for what you're doing on it.
And to be fair, I think it's about three times the size of the Rialto board. So there was definitely a decision made. But no, I agree. I think I said it at the start, right? There is a deluxe edition of this. And yeah, the little so the transport routes are represented by standees, and there's like a cab and a ferry and a streetcar. Those are nice wooden etched, silk screened, and like, yeah, it'd be nice to pick up the little yellow car, but so unnecessary, right? Like more so than the other games in this. Now I got to admit, metal coins for the money, but again, money in this game isn't money. You're not spending money. It's literally just a token to show I've activated this guy. Right. Like, yeah, part of it, we see it as, yeah, it's in the New York theme. Maybe you're bribing them to do the work, but it's not like you're collecting currency and making exchange rates or anything. Right. And like there, I want metal coins. Right. I want my pennies and my dimes and I want them to feel different. No, this is just like it's the anchors from Hamburg. Right. It's fulfilling kind of the same role. It's showing you how often you can activate your characters whether they've been activated or not. So to be fair, this one, like, I don't feel at all bad that I don't have the deluxe edition here, and I can't see anything that I'd want to upgrade. Now, of course, the biggest problem with New York City, we mentioned it earlier, is the lazy translation from the German edition. There are important rules that just aren't there. And this hasn't been fixed as far as I can tell, because I went to the Queen Games website today and I downloaded the rulebook that is on their webpage, and it's the same as mine. It's identical. Like, step four of setup says, then reveal a certain number of stacks. What number? Reveal how many? It doesn't tell you that certain number is the player count plus one. And you don't find any rules for refilling the character market, which you generally assume if you buy something from a market and there's a deck, you put new ones out, right? Like as a hobby gamer. But if you played Rialto doesn't have decks. And if the buildings are bought, they're gone. So if you are coming from the original game, that is a very valid question. Are you stuck with the people who come up at the beginning of the game, or do more come out? So that one's important. There's other ones. Like, you won't find... nothing about what to do if you don't have first and second place during a prestige auction, right? The whole, if one bids, discard both tokens. If no one bids, you just discard them both. But if only one player bids, they pick one and toss the other out. And the fact that you can decide whether to place them or not, right? Like, you win the auction and go, I have a plus six token for yellow. I don't want those up because I'm not winning either of those. I just want to toss it out. That's not mentioned. Now, the one about the reserve being open, to be fair, the picture of setup shows them face up, but then it also shows players' hands face up, and you don't play the game that way.
That part where we got in the setup the first time we were playing, and we got to the part where it says then reveal a certain number of stacks, like, I remember that was we had to stop and we're all searching online, and it was just, it's a barrier to fun and to playing the game, and that's a bad experience. If this is your intro to Stefan Feld in the City series, that's not a good stepping point.
Right. And one thing I noticed that did confuse some people is that there is a on the board, there's some setup information that people can mistake for the information that is missing in certain cards. Yes. It's not for that.
That's telling you how many pairs that draft from.
But it can be confusing for that.
So to compare New York City to Rialto, this is my personal opinion. New York City wins out completely, like utterly, except for the rule book issue. Assuming you've got a fixed rule book and you know what to fix, you've listened to us, you know the rule mistakes. There's just so much more variety here and player agency. There are more options, more valid choices, which come from two big changes. The big one being that you draft two sets from pairs of cards. In Rialto, you lay out a row of six cards for every player, and then every player drafts those six cards. That is, like, compared to drafting pairs, is night and day for be able to actually get what you want and manage your hand. The second is the randomized characters with all kinds of abilities split over five levels. In Rialto, there were 12 building types. It's a little 3x4 grid, and the buildings do the same every game. Like, they're always going to have the same buildings available every game. And if you buy one building, sells out, you can't get it again. Whereas this is going to be random every time. And then there's the improved graphic design. Like, if you look at Rialto, it is a very busy board, and the iconography is not the best. It's just, this looks much prettier. And despite the fact I think the board's too big, by making it that big, it is so easy to look and see who's winning, right? Like, the giant skyscrapers on the large boroughs makes it very easy to say. And I will say, unlike a review of Hamburg, where I say I would still happily play Bruges, in this case, Rialto's going to end up on my two-cell pile.
Yeah, I have to admit, I have the dimmest memory of playing Rialto once many years ago, so I can't really compare the two, so I just have to nod and smile to everything you're saying. But
now, of course, what this means is if you enjoy Rialto, you should be looking to pick up New York City. Even if you just like it a bit, like, there's a lot to like in this update. Like, so far of the Feld City series, this seems to be the most significant improvement from the original into a newer, better game out of the ones we played. Now, if you are a Feld fan who hasn't tried Rialto, I think you'll enjoy New York City. Yes, it is lighter than most of Feld's other games, but it's still got that nice brain burn potential. Especially in the last round of the game. This is a game where you're playing pretty quick until that last round's when the AP comes out, right? Where everyone is trying to do everything they can to squeeze out just a few more points. Now, on the flip side, if you're like, I don't like Feld games, they're too long and complicated, give New York City a chance, because this might be the right Feld for you. Plus, like I said, I think this is a great gateway to Stefan Feld style of games.
Yeah, I agree that this is a great gateway to Stefan Feld's games, to the games in the City Collection. It's easy to learn, but still meaty enough to give you that Feld experience, and it's super quick to get to the table.
Now, here's another group. You like auctions, single bid auctions, where you bid once, right? It comes around the table, gets to you, you get one chance to bid, you win, or you're winning or you're not. This is the game for you. The only other game I know with this many auctions in a row is Strasbourg, which, hey, is also Stefan Feld that came out later. And I'm going to call this out here because I learned this while doing research for this episode, hot off the press. Strasbourg is coming back as the 10th game in the City series, Valencia, with artwork from the Miko, which I got to say is a weird mix because I am used to Miko doing fantasy. So I am looking forward to this. But yeah, if you dig auctions, grab New York City, and then, you know, you'll have something to play until Valencia comes out.
I am so looking forward to seeing what that looks like visually, and I am super psyched to try it out.
Well, that's it for our trip to New York City. Checking the itinerary, it looks like our next stop on the Stefan Feld City Collection tour will be Vienna, and an update to La Isla, one of Feld's most unique games.
Now, if you played New York City, we would love to hear your thoughts. If you haven't, how about you tell us what your favorite Feld is? Is it one of the updates or one of the originals?
Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons. Ron F., Thank you, Ron.
Brian Van Beek. Thank you, Brian.
William Fisher. Thank you.
Andrew Dacey. Thank you, Andrew.
Danielle and Owen. Sorry you couldn't join us on Friday. Hopefully we'll see you the next Wednesday we record. Thank you.
Sean P. Kelly. Thank you, fellow Sean. Well, your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but you can find us all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Don't forget, if you'd like to get all of the show notes for this episode, along with links to everything we just talked about, you can find it at tabletopbellhop.com.
If you have questions for us that you would like us to answer during a future Ask the Bellhop segment, please reach out either by email or just message us on Instagram.
Thank you so much for joining us today. And if you like what you heard, I would love it if you would post a review over on iTunes. And while you're there, subscribe and get notified of upcoming episodes.
That's all for tonight.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And game on.